Yeah. Jesus, oh, my God. 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 Jesus Hi, good morning, everyone. Good morning. There was an advice that we could only have 10 people here. So everybody has got a view. and go to other car and hold on there. So the 10 included me and the priest and the grave diggers also people, so everybody has got to go. But we don't want the police to come and charge anyone. We promise you we don't want that burden and all that right now. After we'll call back. If we need to go with the beer Paul Bears, we'll call you all back. But everybody can stay. So 10 included live screen, please, myself, and all the other families required, but everybody else can't see you. Thank you.
Yes. That's my brother.
His two sisters were daughters?
Yes.
Why?
But you don't want the family man to be here and not the singer? You prefer the singer to be here?
They will sleep after.
So you're okay.
They have YouTube, they have
all right. You're okay with Dominic taking a place of one of the family members.
Yes,
you need to put on your mask, eh? You need to cover your nose.
Hold on.
He's okay with Dominic taking the place of a family member. Mm. So if he's okay with that, then all right. Once we have the test, okay? All right.
Okay. All right. I respect your decision.
No, it's up to the family. I can't say who's to be here. It's up to the family. But if the family is okay that you have somebody who can sing and one member of the family doesn't be here,
yeah,
that's okay. If you wanted the family member to be here,
I would sing.
So it doesn't matter. It's okay with me?
Yes.
It's okay with me. Once we have the numbers, either way, it's okay with me. So if he's okay with the family member not being here, and with the
I am representing on behalf of Brian.
I am
Brian's fiance, so you can't tell me I can't be here.
You cannot be here. Not supposed to be here.
I'm not supposed to be here. Who was in the hospital, right?
I don't care. Okay.
I'm sorry.
This is too much now.
Everybody else out.
One person with Uncle Raleigh and everybody, whoever in charge of the thing, everybody else out.
Well, that's my two people here.
Right.
Okay,
right.
Man, okay. I got your two people.
Mama, your two people.
Kinara,
Talano, there we go.
There we go, come
that
on.
That is it.
Talano, what?
Okay? Yeah. You saw the reading already?
No.
You want to come and take a look at it, or it'll be all right? You read in church normally?
No.
It is this number three here. It is a reading from the Book of Wisdom. You don't read what is read. You just go right down, and then you pause, and the reading will go on. You're singing a song?
Yeah.
Okay, so it'll just be the reading. I don't think I have any words there, though. Funny words up here, so I wouldn't feel anything.
Okay.
We shall keep the songs
as short as
possible. If you sing, when you finish singing, I will receive the body and start. So you start with us.
Yes.
As we gather here, we gather in the name of the Lord. And Jesus says when we gather in his name, when two or three are gathered in his name, that he is there also. So we welcome him amongst us today. He who is the Prince of Peace, and and we ask him to bring peace to us at this time. Times like this, when we say farewell to a loved one, they can be very trying and tested times. And understandably, sometimes emotions are patients are stretched and emotions are high, and sometimes we have to deal patience and understanding of one another. It's a difficult time. And so we pray for the God of peace to bring peace into our hearts, for each and every one of us to know that we gather here in His name, and whatever we do in His name, we have to do in a spirit of peace and togetherness, united in His love. And so we gather here today for this, for the task of saying farewell to our brother Francis and to commit him to the merciful hands of our Lord. As I say, it is a time of grief, it's a time of sadness, of pain, but it's also a time when we renew our trust in Christ, who by dying on the cross has freed us from eternal death, and by rising has opened for us the gates of heaven. So let us pray for our brother Francis, that he may share in Christ's victory, and let us pray for ourselves, that the Lord may grant us the gift of His loving consolation. God of loving kindness, listen favorably to our prayers, strengthen our belief that your Son has risen from the dead, and our hope that your servant Francis will also rise again. We ask this through our Lord Jesus Christ, your Son, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God forever and ever. Amen. Amen.
A reading from the Book of Wisdom.
Good morning, everyone. My name is Kinara Burton, and we are here today to celebrate the life of Francis Gonzalez. Francis was known for being a caretaker. He cared for others more than himself. He could be how sick or how busy, and once you call, Uncle was on his way. He was a jack of all trades. Anything he gave Uncle to do, he could do it. And he did it with diligently and precisely. His measurements were never off. My uncle loved his belly, and he loved to cook. He always said, if you like to eat, you must like to cook. One of our favorite dishes from him was his spinach dumpling and stew pork. He had a bad habit of passing when you're eating and tipping meat out of your plate. He was everyone's personal driver. No matter the location, you call Uncle and say you need a job, and Uncle started his engine. I remember when I was younger, we would ask him to carry us for a drive, and he would take the car and carry us right around the corner, and that little drive would mean the world to us. All these were traits on how reliable he was. Children were his weakness. He was always taking any child he met to the shop and buy them snacks. Another one of his weaknesses were his children. He had three children, Brian, Mark, and Amanda. Though if you were to ask him, he would say he had four, the fourth child being me. For the first few years of my life, Uncle and his wife, Alice, may her soul rest in peace, took care of me. He was the first person I ever called Daddy until the day he died. I called him Daddy. He treated me as his own, and for that, I'm forever grateful. In the midst of it all, my uncle lived a full life. He lived his life to the fullest and never let anyone get in the way of his happiness. When I was told to write this eulogy, it was hard at first because there were so many emotions and memories to put into 5 minutes. So I wrote this poem to summarize it. Tell me who I am without my earthly parents. What should I do with this empty feeling I have inside? Who am I? I do not feel like myself. I can still hear your voice call on my name even though I know you're not there. You taught us how to read, a measuring level, drive, love, laugh, and so much more. But in all the lessons and tricks you taught us, you never taught us how to jumpstart our hearts when you left us. The harsh reality of knowing that you won't be there to make us laugh or pinch and bulky us for no reason. My mind knows you're God, but my heart refuses to believe it. It refuses to let another part of itself break away and go with you, though it would never ask you to stay and suffer. Although it hurts and it feels like the days will never get better, we will continue to build the puzzle of this picture we call life, using the lessons and tricks you left for us, in hopes of one day meeting again. I know that your soul is at peace and that you have gone to meet your true love. Do us a favor and tell her that we miss her and we love her. May your soul rest in peace.
Reading from the Book of Wisdom. The virtuous man, though he die from his time, will find rest. Length of days is not what makes age honorable, nor number of years the true measure of life. Understanding, this is man's gray hairs, untarnished life, this is ripe old age. He has sought to please God, so God has loved him. As he was living among sinners, he has been taken up. He has been carried off, so that evil may not warp his understanding, or treachery seduce his soul. For the fascination of evil throws good things into the shade, and the whirlwind of desire corrupts a simple heart. Coming to perfection in so short a while, he achieved long life, his soul being pleasing to the Lord. He has taken him quickly from the wickedness around him. Yet people look on uncomprehending. It does not enter their heads that grace and mercy await the chosen of the Lord, and protection his holy ones. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
The Lord is my shepherd. He is Lord and I am his guest. Fresh and green are the pastures where he leads me to my rest. Near peaceful waters he leads me to cheer up my cheerless heart. He guides me on the safe path. He will always do his part. If I should never walk in the valley of darkness, no evil would I fear. You are there to show the way. If I should never walk in the valley of darkness, your crook and your staff, they will lead me to the day. The sight of my foes, you cool my head with oil, and my cup now overflows. Surely goodness and kindness will be with me all the way. I will thank him every day.
We stand for the gospel of creation.
Alleluia, alleluia, alleluia. I am the resurrection, I am the life. He who believes in me, even if he dies, he shall live forever. Alleluia, alleluia, alleluia.
The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
A reading from the Holy Gospel according to Matthew.
Glory to you.
Jesus spoke this parable to his disciples. The kingdom of heaven will be like this. 10 bridesmaids took their lamps and went to meet the bridegroom. 5 of them were foolish and 5 were sensible. The foolish ones did take their lamps, but they brought no oil, whereas the sensible ones took flasks of oil as well as their lamps. The bridegroom was late, and they all grew drowsy and fell asleep. But at midnight, there was a cry. The bridegroom is here. Go out and meet him. At this, all those bridesmaids woke up and trimmed their lamps. And the foolish ones said to the sensible ones, give us some of your oil. Our lamps are going out. But they replied, there may not be enough for us and for you. You had better go to those who sell it and buy some for yourselves. They had gone off to buy it when the bridegroom arrived. Those who were ready went in with him to the wedding hall, and the door was closed. The other bridesmaids arrived later. Lord, Lord, they said, open the door for us. But he replied, I tell you solemnly, I do not know you. So stay awake, because you do not know either the day or the hour. The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to
you,
Lord Jesus Christ.
Let us be seated. I think it was Saint Benedict who said that we should try to live each day as though it was our last. And he said that in the context, not in a morbid thing, like you're thinking of death all the time, but really that if today was the end, you know, how would you live it? How would you live today if you thought, well, you didn't have all the time in the world, which is what we normally think we have. You know, you would want to do the important things. You would want to make sure, like Jesus says, you know, that you were staying awake. I think to live each day as though it was your last is to stay awake. That you don't know the day or the hour, so you get prepared for every day. And you're ready for every day. This struck me very forcefully many years ago in terms of the quality of the day, and I think of how you live your life and each day. And I think that's what comes through in that first reading, that it's not the length of our years, you know, it's not the amount of time we spend on this earth, but in fact it's the quality of our life. It talks about understanding. This is man's gray hair, untarnished life. This is ripe old age. So it's talking about the quality of our life rather than the length of our days. And if we lived each day as though it was our last, I think we would have such an attention to how we live, pay such an attention that it would be a day of quality. And it wouldn't be so how many days we have, but how we spend those days. As I say, many years ago, the fragility and the shortness of life struck me very powerfully. I was in seminary. It was the day, many of us here might remember, it was the day that Archbishop Pantin died. And although he wasn't a young man, so you can't say that, you know, he died in his youth, but we weren't expecting it. And he was such a powerful influence on so many of us in our lives that, it, you know, we felt it. The whole nation felt it, I think. I felt it. It took me a long time to come to terms of the reality of it. What struck me that day when I heard the news of his death, and I realized that, you know, we just don't know the day or the hour, and that death could come at any time. It struck me very powerfully that day how important it is to live our lives with a certain quality to it. And particularly, I thought, you know, in our relationships. Because I thought to myself, you know, think of all the things that the differences we have with each other and the quarrels we have with each other and so forth. And I thought to myself, you know, that at times like this, when somebody such an influence in your life and so passes away, that it makes you realize that those things, you know, what is important, really is what I'm trying to say. What are the things that are really important, that are value that we should hold on to? And it really makes us think that some of the difficulties, the quarrels we have with each other that we should, you know, we should let go, we should dispense because they're not significant in the overall scheme of things. That really it is to make sure that our life is so well lived that when the time comes that we're ready to meet the Lord. And so it put into perspective for me, you know, those sorts of things. I remember thinking that clearly on that day, you know, whatever differences I had with others, whatever quarrels, if today was my end, how was I going to reconcile that? How was I going to clear that up? You wouldn't have the time. And you would leave it, you know, you're going with that baggage. And so it hit me forcefully that if every day you were prepared and you let go of all these things and concentrated on the important things, the things that the Lord would want, that then you would be ready for when you leave. And I share that with you today, even in the context of this gospel with the bridesmaids, you know, because it talks about 10 bridesmaids. All of them went. It was not like they were disinterested, like they don't care or whatever. They all went. But 5 went fully prepared. They went with their lamps, they went with flasks of oil. Whereas 5 went with lamps, but they didn't take any extra oil. And so it's a thing of being prepared, I guess, for any eventuality. You know, I guess they didn't take it to conquer. They know he might be late, it might take some time, we might need some extra. They just went with what they had at the time and so on. They didn't kind of plan ahead. And we can look at all kinds of circumstances of life to relate to that. You know, my father, God rest his soul, he used to say, you know, if you're going somewhere, you know, it's taking so much X time to go there, leave 5 or 10 minutes earlier because you don't know what you might meet on the way and some obstacle or something that you didn't cater for. So at least you know you will be on time when you get there. I don't think it's a lesson I learned well from him, but I know that he used to say that. You know, so it's a thing of being prepared. It's giving a little extra leeway or taking a little extra with you so that for whatever happens, you know that you're ready to meet all eventualities. Okay, in the context of the these bridesmaids, it would seem to me that we can look at this oil that they took, the flask of oil, that the sensible ones who took those flasks of oil, that the oil is like the oil of virtue, is the virtues that we live. You know, and the three theological virtues of faith, hope, and love. That our flasks need to be filled with those virtues. So we live a virtuous life that is full. We're not half empty, we're not running out, but full of virtue. And we'll touch on each one just briefly, individually, you know, faith, which I think is so lacking in our world today. So many people have fallen out of faith, who have no faith, who don't believe in a good God, who can save us, and not only that, but to trust him that he will save us. I think for many people, we have lost that trust in a good God who wants to save us and who will save us if we give him a chance to. So faith in a good God, faith and hope, and a hope of what? And I suppose we're all hopeful of all sorts of things, that things will turn out better, that we will get over the coronavirus, that, you know, all the difficulties in life, you know, we're hopeful we overcome them. But a hope, the theological virtue of hope is really our hope in the time to come, that heaven is our final objective. It is where we are destined for. It certainly is where God wants us to be with him. Today, not the gospel we read for this service, but in the liturgy of the church today, in the masses today, the gospel is from John, that very popular one, what we hear at funerals oftentimes. Do not let your hearts be troubled. That is the gospel for today in the liturgy for the church today. Do not let your hearts be troubled. Trust in God. Trust in me still. And Jesus goes on to say that he's going to prepare a place for us in our Father's house. And when he's prepared that place, he will come back to take us with us so that where he is, we may be also. That tells us very powerfully that Jesus, God himself, wants us to be with him. And because he desires us to be with him, that's the beginning of our desire to be with him. He desires it first. He loves first, loves us first, and then we love him too. He desires it, and we desire it because he wants that. And so our hope is in heaven. That is where our heavenly homeland is. That's where our true homeland is. Not this time where we are on a pilgrimage journey, and it's only for a time, but you know that we will be in heaven forever with the Lord. That's our hope, and that through Him, His help, that Jesus' help, and the power of the Holy Spirit, that we will be able to get there. Not on our own steam, but with His help. And that's why we have to stay so close to the Lord, because our hope is in Him and what He offers us, what He promises us in heaven. Faith, hope, and love. And what is that love? Love of God, because He loves us first, and because He's God. And love of our neighbor as ourself. Because we see each other, and that's why the love of God has to come first. Because when we have our love of God, our Heavenly Father, when we see each and everyone as our brothers and sisters in the Lord, then we can't say we love the Lord and not love our brothers and sisters. See, and John says that in one of his letters as well, you know, that we can't say we love God who we never saw when we don't love our neighbor who we see every day, to paraphrase. And so that love, and I think we can't love our neighbor in the right way that we're supposed to love our neighbor, unless we have that love of God first. That is the first love. And when we have that love, and we have to seek each day to grow in that love, when we have that love of God, when we're really along that journey, advanced along that journey of loving God, because I guess we're always on the journey, we're always seeking, we're always improving. When we have that love, then we love our neighbor as ourselves, because it is out of the love of God, and because we see that person as a child of God, destined for heavenly glory like ourselves. That's what God wants for everyone. And so we see our neighbor in that context, and we can love our neighbor. And our neighbor, of course, we can't restrict what that definition is, but you know, it's to love really everyone, and particularly those who are close to us in a family situation, because that's where we learn to love, and then we grow from there, and we love others outside of our family situation. And so faith, hope, and love, that those virtues should fill our flask, you know, those like oil of virtue, and if we concentrate on that, then we'll be ready for when the bridegroom comes, when the Lord calls for us. Today, we entrust our brother Francis to the merciful hands of our Lord, and you know, God is faithful to His promises, and today we just have to be confident and trusting in our loving and merciful God, that and as we commend Francis's soul to our Lord. But we also have to look at our own lives, because we are still on the journey of preparing for that day. For all of us, that day is going to come at some time, sooner or later. Will we be prepared? And we need to listen to this gospel today, the five foolish, the five wise ones, and see if in our own life of faith, hope, and love, see if we are only doing halfway and giving of ourselves halfway. So, you know, it's not that we say we don't believe in God, that we don't love God, you know, we may say all those things, but the five foolish bridesmaids, they went, and because they were interested, they were invited, and they wanted to be there, they went knocking on the door, but they were not fully prepared. What in our life needs to be filled to make us properly prepared for when that day comes, as surely it will come for each and every one of us? And I think that is an attentiveness to the Lord, an attentiveness to what He wants in our life, and that is a deep prayer life, and asking of Him of what He's seeking from us, paying attention to all that He asks, paying attention to faith, to our journey with faith, in faith, hope, and love. So it is that attentiveness, and it is, I think, a full giving of ourselves. And we can only take the example of Jesus Himself, God Himself, who went on the cross to take each and every one of us out of our sin, to redeem us from the clutches of the evil one. That He gave Himself ultimate price going on the cross. And He gives us Himself even today in the Holy Eucharist, body, blood, soul, and divinity. That God Himself gives Himself fully to us in trying to help us to be with Him forever in heaven. And if He gives us Himself, surely we have to give ourselves in return. And I think that's the fullness of the flask of oil that, you know, we're prepared to give everything. And it's, we're not holding back anything. It's not a lukewarm life of faith. It's not mediocre. It's not now, but not then, or sometimes, but every day, to give ourselves fully to the Lord. And it's not easy. thanks be to God. He tells us he will be with us always, and he nourishes us, he strengthens us, and he makes it possible. And it is in there, it is in him that we have our hope. Our hope is in the name of the Lord. So today we say farewell to Francis, and we thank God for his life, and we pray with confidence that he is with the Lord at this time. But we remember that we are all on our way, and we have to be ready for that when that day comes. What in my life needs to change to make myself ready? And maybe today we have to overcome some of the things in our life that are keeping us from loving as we are called to love. And as difficult as that is, you know, to ask the Lord to help us to be reconciled with one another, to overcome our differences, because in the perspective of eternity, they are so insignificant. And really, we want to be ready for when the Lord calls, because he wants us to be with him, and we want to be with him as well. Let us entrust our lives to God today and ask him to help us to overcome every difficulty on the way of love. Amen.
Amen.
Let us stand together. God the Almighty, Father, raised Christ his Son from the dead. With confidence we ask him to save all his people, living and dead. For Francis, who in baptism was given the pledge of eternal life, that he may now be admitted to the company of the saints, Lord, hear us.
Lord graciously hear us.
For our brother who ate the body of Christ, the bread of life, that he may be raised up on the last day, Lord, hear us.
Lord graciously hear us.
For our deceased relatives and friends, and for all who have helped us, that they may have the reward of their goodness, Lord, hear us.
Lord graciously hear us.
For those who have fallen asleep in the hope of rising again, that they may see God face to face, Lord, hear us.
Lord graciously hear us.
We pray for the family and friends of our brother Francis, those who are able to be here, those who cannot be here with us today, and who are mourning the loss of their loved one at this time, that they may be consoled in their grief by the Lord, who himself wept at the death of his friend, Lazarus. Lord, hear us.
Lord graciously hear us.
And for all of us assembled here to worship in faith, that we may be gathered together again in God's kingdom, Lord, hear us.
Lord graciously hear us.
With longing for the coming of God's kingdom, let us pray to the Father in the words our Savior gave us.
Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil.
Let us pray. God, our shelter and our strength, you listen in love to the cry of your people. Hear the prayers we offer for our departed brothers and sisters, especially for Francis on this day. Cleanse them of their sins and grant them the fullness of redemption. We ask this through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
Amen. Let us be seated for the commendation. Trusting in God, we have prayed together for Francis, and now we come to the last farewell. There is sadness in parting, but we take comfort in the hope that one day we shall see Francis again and enjoy his friendship. Although the congregation will disperse in sorrow, the mercy of God will gather us together again in the joy of his kingdom. Therefore, let us console one another in the faith of Jesus Christ.
It must have been cold there in my shadow to never have sunlight on your face. You were content to let me shine, that's your way. You always walk a step behind, so I was the one with all the glory. ever know that you're my hero.
Father of Mercies, we commend our brother Francis in the sure and certain hope that together with all who have died in Christ, he will rise with him on the last day. Merciful Lord, turn towards us and listen to our prayers. Open the gates of paradise to your servants and help us who remain to comfort one another with assurances of faith until we all meet in Christ and are with you and with our brother forever. Because God has chosen to call our brother Francis to him from this life to himself, we commit his body to the earth. For we are dust, and unto dust we shall return. But the Lord Jesus Christ will change our mortal bodies to be like his in glory, for he is risen, the firstborn from the dead. So let us commend our brother to the Lord, that the Lord may embrace him in peace and raise up his body on the last day. Amen.
Amen.
Let us stand together. Bow your heads and pray for God's blessing. Merciful Lord, you know the anguish of the sorrowful. You are attentive to the prayers of the humble. Hear your people who cry out to you in their need and strengthen their hope in your lasting goodness. We ask this through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
Amen. Eternal rest grant unto him, O Lord.
And let the perpetual light shine upon him.
May he rest in peace.
Amen.
May his soul and the souls of all the faithful departed through the mercy of God rest in peace.
Amen.
Amen. Francis, may the angels lead you into paradise. May the martyrs come to welcome you and lead you to the holy city, the new and eternal Jerusalem. May the choirs of angels welcome you and lead you to the bosom of Abraham, and where Lazarus is poor no longer, may you find eternal rest.
Amen. Amen.
And may the peace of God, which is beyond all our understanding, keep your hearts and minds in the knowledge and love of God and of his Son, our Lord Jesus Christ.
Amen.
And may Almighty God bless you all, the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
Amen. Our service is ended. Let us go in peace to love and serve the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
We remember how you loved us to your death, and still we celebrate, for you are with us here, and we believe that we will see you when you come in your glory. Lord, we remember, we celebrate. We believe.
Have you ever been to Paris and anything about how it is? Fantastic.
Thank you.
I'll come this way.
Yeah, this is the better way.
Go
on. Yeah, go on this way.
So he will come then, Rebecca.
To him.
So I'm gonna get an accident right now.
I have not too much people for you.
Thank you. Take your time, eh? All right, you're up.